He ain't clerk for Supreme Court justice. He's clerk for a grocery store. Worked his way through law school, elected the House in 86. Wife, Teresa, judge of Rogers County, nicknamed Brutus. He made a historic motion. You've seen it. I couldn't find the constitutional language, but it's very specific language. Going on to be a district judge of incredible note in northeastern Oklahoma. Whatever you want to talk about, Your Honor, but the floor is yours for as much time as you like, somewhere below 15 minutes. Thank you for coming. And Dwayne drove all the way from Claremore, left the bench today. Would you please welcome him to our
I won't take as long, but I think it might be helpful to kind of realize the district I live in. It's what I would call suburban. It was actually a junior college. It's now Cal State University, part of the OU system, Rogers State University. There's a veteran center there, which when I got elected, had really not been built too long. It had been added on to since then. So some government money being spent there, what goes on is really important. Higher education obviously was important then. Senator Taylor was the senator that I served with. The school was a huge deal to him. It's noted by the fact that there's now a library named after him. So that kind of gives you a little bit of background of the things that were important to me. I was not backed by the House leadership when I ran. I ran twice. The first time I ran, there were three people that ran. I won the primary and lost the runoff. 4 years later, I ran again. I think there were five people in the primary. I was not one of the people that was backed by anybody, so I was kind of a lone ranger. Got elected. Then I did meet with the speaker. I think the first session I served as the vice chairman of the Criminal Justice Committee. And then was fortunate enough to be appointed to the chairman of the Judiciary Committee. But, kind of like what you heard a little bit about, there were some things that I think I was told was going to happen that didn't happen. Some of them were probably nicky things like the office you were going to get. It wasn't what I was doing. And so, I mean, and that's not a good reason to be mad at people, and that wasn't the reason. I was disappointed, but I wasn't mad. My recollection, and these gentlemen can correct me if anything I say is wrong, but my recollection is that the session started off in such a way, kind of like what Steve was saying, is there was just a lot of people who were disappointed about various things. Part of that, I think, is just from the fact that, you know, the longer you're the speaker, the more baggage you're going to build up over a certain period of time. And I'm like both of them, I had no animosity towards Speaker Barker. I thought he was a good person. I think he tried to do a good job. I just think he got to a point where he became apparent with it. I think a lot of people would back that up. I think there was a lot of talk about the fact that he had his office checked daily to make sure that there weren't listening devices and things like that. Maybe that was a good thing. maybe he had a reason to be concerned about that kind of stuff. But so I would say that being from a suburban district, I considered myself to be a progressive. I like to do progressive things. And I think the group that ultimately became the T-Bar 12 were all kind of the like mind if you looked at their districts and what was important to them and those kind of things. And they just did not see a progressive agenda occurring. My recollection, again, is when we first started meeting, it was not in any way, shape, or form with the idea that we were going to try to change the leadership. I think it was kind of along the lines of what you heard earlier. It was to keep track of what was going on, see if we could make changes where we could, and see if, you know, maybe sometime during the course of the session things got better. And we started meeting probably at least midway, if before that session. And so, again, my recollection, Cal, correct me if I'm wrong, at some point in time, we signed, I think we all signed with it. Did I sign with it?
Yeah, you're talking about the letter. Oh, yes, to Speaker Barker, yes. 22 of us signed that, went in to see him in the time frame of April-ish. That's when Mr. Barnes of Matco had put those full-page ads in. He was a higher agent. Davis waved out. We went in and said, don't make him come before the...
And he didn't like that.
Barker thought it was wrong, too, but he was dominated by certain people.
And so I think that and the fact that as things went along, none of what anybody was trying to get done, plus that just kind of led to the final version where I think this group decided a change had to occur. And my part, other than being part of the TBAR 12 and these kind of things, was I think it was because I was the youngest, they looked at me and they said, you'll be the one to make the motion. I don't remember volunteering for that.
Sheriff, put up the slide with the 10 people identified, the one with the seats and the colors, if you would.
I haven't watched the actual video of that day. I mean, I never have seen it. I've heard people talk about it, but I'm told I'm well, that's true or not.
Yes, it was true, and I'll show you exactly what you were doing, because I was one seat away, and I told you he was recognized because we were sure that Glover, Davis, whatever, wouldn't think anything's coming from this newbie, and he had stuffed this thing to his chin in order to sort of quit shaking. He's making a motion like that, literally. Do you remember that?
Yeah. After I took all the time, I'm going to interrupt you. The way I remember it was that he was recognized, and someone was in the chair that was not the speaker and not the speaker pro tem. Do you recall who was in the chair at first?
It was Glover was in the chair.
No, was he in the chair? Yeah. Okay, he was in the chair. No, that's right. Glover was in the chair, and he made the motion.
So I didn't recognize you.
Yeah, and is that when he tried to...
Well, then Jim Hamilton tried to play the
motion. Jim Hamilton was a former pro tem in the Senate. Who had come back to the House. Hamilton's dad had been a pro tem in the Senate also. Hamilton sat right here, and he was a real stickler for tradition and rules, and smart guy, hell of a smart guy, lawyer. He was trying to screw it up. He knew nothing about it. He was a four. We knew, remember the 1, 2, 3, 4, we knew we'd never get Hamilton. So carry on with the story.
Well, so anyway, it finally got to the breaking point, and obviously these meetings became meetings with the idea that there had to be a change in leadership. And I don't remember how many times we met at Linda Larison's house.
We met at Linda's house only, well, perhaps several. The one serious time was after all the dinners the night of the 18th scattered throughout Oklahoma City.
Right. So her husband actually had, I think he's the one that had found this. He had brought some information, and we looked at Mason's manual on kind of the parliamentary procedure manual. And so he had actually found a case involving another state dealing with the process of how you actually move to remove the speaker, what the process was. And that's kind of where that language came from. The night before, at the infamous Howard Johnson's Hotel, which is where I stayed, Representative Pilgrim was researching the issue that later came up about what happens as it did, because Representative Glover was going to relinquish the chair to Speaker Barker so he could preside over the motion, and Representative Pilgrim pointed out the fact that the parliamentary procedure didn't allow you to do that if the motion was about the person themselves, and they could not preside over that.
And then you had the motion by Representative Hamilton to table,
which that motion did not pass, and so then we went on.
You remember these two freshmen that we talked about, Pilgrim.